Okay, then I think we'll say welcome everybody to this first webinar in the Drilling and Well Technology Network under the umbrella FORCE. We are a fairly new group under the FORCE umbrella, and we decided that an exciting theme for our first webinar would be multilaterals, and the response, 166 has signed up for this webinar. Very good. And I see quite a lot of familiar faces in the feed. So that's good. Hey, alle sammen. We are recording this. So if you have to leave and need to come back, or if you some of your friends, colleagues did not have the opportunity to watch this, you can look at it at a later time. And also informed by Gorm that the presentation will be distributed later. You will all be forcefully put on mute to avoid a lot of disturbance, so Lynn will manage that. And if you have any questions, you can post them in the feed, and we'll intervene regularly with the GOMS so that we have a good dialogue, but a controlled dialogue in this webinar. And that was really all I wanted to say. Now, Gorm Liland will tell us a little bit about multilaterals of the past, multilaterals of the present, and multilaterals of the future. Gorm Liland has more than 10 years experience with Halliburton as a senior advisor on multilaterals. He's also worked with Equinor on multilaterals, and I had the pleasure to work with him on Gjøa, where we have several very good multilaterals. So I'm looking forward to being pulled out as an example of previous very skilled colleague that Gorm has worked with. And he's also worked with ConocoPhillips and some others. So, and many of you have met Gorm earlier during presentations or professionally. So I guess you know him, and you also know that he is a very skilled painter, artist. So, the UR logo with the multilaterals is actually an oil painting that Gorm did when we opened the UR field in 2010. So with that, I give the word to Gorm, and you have the word for the next 1.5 hour, I guess. Go ahead.
Thank you very much for a nice introduction, Gerhard. And good morning, everybody. I'm very glad to be invited to the FORCE Forum to talk about multilaterals as an IOR initiative. That's actually one of my favorite topics within our industry. My presentation today will give an introduction to the MLT history, what we have done on the Norwegian continental shelf. I'll show you what this technology can do for you, and hopefully I'll improve the understanding of this being a mature technology that you can take advantage of today. Then my first presentation will take about 45 to 50 minutes, and then we'll do a 10-minute break. And of course, we'll go through Duva, which I have got information from Gerhard on. Gosh, what could have been done on that field? And after that, we'll do all the questions before we end today's session. Today, I'll discuss a little bit, about installations on the Norwegian continental shelf. I'll show you some technical solutions and developments, and mainly focus on the new stuff, or relatively new stuff, coming to the market. I'll go through probably the most interesting part, which is the field development benefits. Why should you actually do this, and how can you adapt it? I have been asked to talk about risk considerations. It's not my favorite subject, but of course, it's something that you need to think of when you're doing something else than you usually do. After the break, we'll drop into field development alternatives, and then we're discussing Gjøa. And we'll probably make some kind of a discussion in the end there and do the Q&A part just before we have a short wrap-up. On my own, as a personal statement, I should say, I would say that MLTs is often still considered a new technology. And modern MLTs actually kicked off with the modern MWD tools and steerable drilling systems. And of course, horizontal drilling that came in the early 90s as an effective way of increasing the reservoir contact. Saying that, the first MLTs that I have dug up information about was actually drilled in 1953. That was done by a drilling engineer called Alexander Grigorian. He was an Azerbaijanian. And it was on the Bashkortostan, just north of Kazakhstan, as you see on the slide to the very right there. This first well had 9 laterals. It had a cost of added cost of about 50%, and it produced about 17 times as much as offset wells or other wells in the field. To that history is also that I don't really know how these wells produced, but I would assume that over time it was relatively good. And and I understand that Mr. Grigorian was actually drilling, or in charge of, I should say, 30 more wells up to the 1980s. And the company actually drilled an additional 100 multilateral wells in this field. To end that story, Grigorian moved to the States in 1980 and became an American citizen. And since there, haven't been able to dig up any further information on him. On the Norwegian continental shelf today, we are doing some of the most, or you are, I should say, the operators are drilling some of the most complex MLT installations in the world. These wells are, most of these wells are subsea wells. They are long horizontals completed with screen sections and AICDs for inflow control to shut off water or unwanted gas. They are equipped with spell packers to seal off areas of non-productive areas in the reservoir section, and they have inflow control valves to be able to choke or shut off each lateral independently. That can be necessary if one lateral, for instance, kicks off with the gas and takes over production of the whole well. These wells have been drilled with up to nearly 20, if not more than 20 kilometers of the reservoir section in one single well. And some of them has been, I'll leave it there. Somebody is actually have the mic on. Can I please turn it off? This slide is quite messy. I don't really like to go into all details here, but anyhow, the main thing on this slide is a number in the lower right corner, which states that 359 installations has been done in totally on the Norwegian continental shelf off the TAM level 5 junctions. TAM level 5, I'll get back to it at the later stage. And this slide is not brand new. So just for Halliburton, we probably installed around 365 installations altogether. And there are other suppliers doing some of the same, but not to the same degree yet. We've had MLTs ongoing since 1996, and 84 or more, almost 85% of these installations are off floaters. And that's due to the huge subsea campaigns that we have in the Norwegian continental shelf. Some of the success. Some of the success factors for these installations are that we have mainly used premier window technology, which means that you have a window that's milled in a casing joint before it's installed, and it's actually wrapped, or I should wrapped with an aluminium sleeve on the outside of the opening in the casing window. That means that we know how where the track is going for the lateral self, and we are milling aluminium. Milling aluminium compared to milling steel means that it's easier to circulate the surface. It doesn't create bird nests as you are milling, and it's lightweight. So it limits the need for cleanup procedures, and steel debris doesn't create as much challenge later in the process of an MLT installation. We also used pretty standardized junctions, and if you look at this slide, you can see that there are ICI junctions, which is the first junctions with inflow that allow control from each lateral. And they're mixed, and it's a relatively small variations to the junctions altogether. Last but not least of the success factors, I'll say that the continuity that Aker BP and Equinor and Aker BP have had on MLT installations has made us keeping a very stable workforce, focusing on what we should do instead of chasing equipment, and that has pushed the technology forward much more rapidly than it would and would have happened if we had done the same on speculation. Yeah, as Gerhard mentioned, it's a field that is close to my heart because I was working on it on the planning phase for quite a few years, and I love to talk about it. The field is actually a gas field, but the oil had to be taken out, and there were four MLT dual MLT wells and three oil producers planned. The operational period for these four dual MLT wells were in 2010 to 2011, and the wells were all completed with a FlexRite ICI junction with a liner deployment systems, which means that we can drop off the lateral liner before we tie the junction back into the lateral completion, and thereby avoid running screens and everything together with the junction. Altogether, the multilateral wells on Gjøa was drilled with 8,200 meters of reservoir section, and more than half of that was in the laterals. In 2012, or maybe it was 13, I'm not sure, I heard a presentation about Gjøa on the one-day seminars in Bergen. And I asked the question about how the dual MLT is produced compared to the single oil producers, because we as service providers don't normally get that information. And the answer was quite encouraging to me, because the answer, as I interpreted it, was that the wells produce as you should expect out of reservoir penetration, period. We're going to touch into technical solutions and developments, and the first thing I will talk a little bit about is MLT classification, and I mentioned TAML, and I'll get back to it now. I'm going to show you a typical MLT installation from Halliburton and how we do that. I'll show you how and all the challenges with MLTs from existing casing and what we are doing to it. We're going to touch into laterals from expandable liners, as Equinor is doing in a large scale on Troll right now. We're going to touch into stimulation and fracking and the challenges that are coming together with wells that require these kind of completions. I'm going to show you a little bit about reservoir completion optimization to visualize what's important when you do a planning of a well before we go into production from an old well bore and see how you can keep that at least on two different types of doings of ways. Sorry. The TAM classifications was actually, or the TAM group was actually set up in the early 90s, and it was set up mainly to clarify how we should separate different types of installations, so we had a decent count on what was done and had an idea of what was and how it was done. This group was consisting of quite a few oil companies and some and all the major service companies doing multilaterals at that time. It goes from TAM level 1 junction, which is an unsupported type of a junction. It's actually just an open hole sidetrack, but you keep both laterals to improve the production. And this is the same type of junction that Alexander Gregorian did on the first well in Bashkirfield in 1953, of course. At TAM level 2 and all the higher levels are actually milled or drilled from cemented casing. It doesn't have to be today, but that's the specific, that's TAM classification of it. At TAM level 2 is an even an open hole lateral, or is this dropped off for cemented lateral out in the dropped off or cemented liner. Or it could actually be like a perforated liner as well. A TAM level 3 is a mechanically connected lateral liner, as a TAM level 4 is a cemented junction. So there is actually the first step where it's actually something else than the formation that holds pressure against the formation. TAM level 4 is the cement that holds pressure. TAM level 5, which is the most popular junction run on the Norwegian continental shelf today, is a junction where it's actually the completion gate that holds pressure against the formation. Level 6 is not commonly used anymore because you use too much hole size, but the specification states that it's a junction where it's a casing system that holds pressure against the formation. A typical Halliburton installation with a multilateral is comprising of three different phases. And we split them up like that because that's how we send people offshore for to do the jobs themselves. The first phase is to run either a parent casing, and with a pre-mill window and a latch system below. It could all in the case of a new well, of course. I'm only discussing new wells right now. Then the next step, of course, is to drill and The next step is to drill and complete the main bore below the junction, and you state that's not an MLT state. It's just an ordinary well construction phase. Then after we've done that, we install a whipstock and we drill we mill a window, and then the operator is going ahead and drilling the lateral and start to complete it. And you complete that from the bottom and up, of course, but you can do it in sections, as I mentioned on the when I talked about Gjøa, and which I'll get back further back to a bit later in my presentation today. So what you do when you have installed the last section of screens is that back into the main bore with the completion with the running string, and you retrieve the whipstock in the same run. The next step then is to install a deflector, which is basically a completion whipstock, which is going to be placed in the hole for the rest of the life of the well. And the last MLT step is to install the junction itself and tie it back to the screens in the lateral and to seal in the deflector itself. So this is actually the pressure holding container. To complete the well, The well is now completed as an MLT, but to complete the well totally, you run the upper completion with swell package above and on below, or with just a seal assembly into a PBR if it's a dual MLT. Regardless of that, normally that last step of running completion includes running inflow control valves and gauges. To do an MLT from an existing or old casing, there are a few challenges worth mentioning are how is the condition of the casing from earlier, and is it good enough to be used as a well to qualify as a well barrier today? If these two things can't, if you can't get around those two first points, you can just as well, you need to start further, you need to step back and do your well from a higher point in your well bore. Other points that's important is how do you do your depth and azimuth control? How do you actually get a good window geometry that you can use, that you can go into and get back out of during the various phases of an installation? And how do you handle milling debris during the operation so it doesn't create challenges for you further down the road when you're going to do your upper completion installation, for instance, or install the final deflector? Halliburton's solution to this, or at least a part of this challenge, is what we call an extreme grip MLT system, which substitutes the pre-milled window, as I talked about earlier, and which is covering a slotted mule shoot in the very top of a liner hanger, and this design is based on a VersaFlex liner hanger. That means that we have a torque-containing device that we can also run the lower completion on or in the main bore if that's not run earlier. This system also saves a run because you don't have to run the landing profile by itself. And of course, you get when you're running it together with the sand screens in the main bore reservoir, you're getting the landing point at the optimal place in the well, which is probably as close to the sand screens below as possible. And if it's not, you can just space it out and put it in a bit further up in the well, and still saving the same time, the same amount of time. I mentioned the troll field and what we're doing there as a site with using expandable liners. A reason for doing that is that in this area, in the old wells, you can, if you research, it's been one or two MLT wells below here earlier, and all of that has water low, possibly. I don't really know that, of course. And what you do to create a new liner that you could sidetrack from is to pack off this area a 10¾-inch sidetracking ripstock, drill a hole, and run, and you probably open it up to, I don't really know, but whatever, to just reduce the ECD as you're running your liner and you cement it in place. And what's been used on these wells up to now is 8M58 44-pound expandable liner from Venture. And this liner has an ID of 8.6 or similar to a 9M58-inch standard line, 53.5-pound standard liner. So we can use that to run the extreme grip MLT system into afterwards and sidetrack as indicated on this picture. All of these operations, as I understand it, are done through the Christmas tree. And I would assume, I don't have any numbers on it, but I would assume that Equinor is saving about 10 to 15 days on each MLT wells just by doing that. And in top of my head, that's something like 100 in between 100 and 200 million kroners per well. But don't quote me on that. Bad to say on the webcast though. With these wells completed, the upper completions run through all of the junctions, which has a large ID on the main board. And it has with swell packets in between the laterals. And then you can flow control each lateral independently and control it all from surface. So there are swell packets in between here, probably permanent gauges and inflow control valves to choke or shut off each lateral independently. And I presume that these wells are also equipped with autonomous inflow control valves, as I showed you on the big red picture earlier in my presentation. One of the challenges going forward with the mature continental shelf is that a lot of feeds require stimulation and fracking. Some of the issues that you need to be aware of when you discuss that is the fracking pressure is not necessarily and the pressure rating of the junction doesn't necessarily tie together. So higher pressure junctions have been developed and are being developed in more sizes right now. And it's now ready for use on a 7 and 5/8 inch system developed together with Aker BP, and that's what you see on the right side of this slide. Access diameter is another important issue if you're going to do a ball drop sidetracking, if you're going to use a ball drop sidetracking fracking system. And there you're limited by the 3.5 inch with the current system in 9 and 5/8, and you would probably like to have access with balls that's a bit larger than that. But of course, it has some mechanical limitations that we can't go a bolt because you can't make this steel too thin and keep your pressure ratings up. And another issue here is the isolation required as you are stimulating your other wellbore. That may basically means how you're isolating the main bore as you're stimulating the lateral, and how do you retrieve that plug afterwards. Last but not least, I'll say that an issue of how and when you treat your laterals is important. All operators that I talk to would like to do lateral treatments offline, which means after you drill the well, to save rig time, of course. And that is, there are systems coming that offers such solutions, but they're not necessarily ready for this use as of today. But in a year or two, we can do that in 9 and 5/8, and we can also of course continue doing it with 7 and 5/8 and other systems available. The picture to the left here shows is from an open hole MLT system developed for ConocoPhillips a few years back, where we could do a similar operation with offline treatments of the lateral itself, but not the main bore. It's important to optimize a lower completions in the multilateral well to since temporary isolation, cementing and perforation, fracking or gravel packing may be adds too much time if you have to isolate the main bore or lateral after as you're running the completion in the other lateral. So the way you can optimize completion in is first of all that the system that we're using frequently is with the liner deployment system. I mentioned that on Gjøa, and it's still a very common system to be used in all MLT wells installed in Norway, I would say nearly all at least. And that's just stacking the screen sections in top of each other so that you can have an extremely long resource section in both the main bores indicated here, but also in the lateral. And that's why we can complete wells with up to 6+ kilometers on the troll field with sand screens all the way through. Another completion system that actually substitutes gravel pack. Gravel pack is challenging, and gravel pack we have done on a few MLT wells on Peregrino for Equinor successfully, but it takes time because you have to isolate the main bore as you gravel pack the lateral. And a way of getting around there is a system that we're looking into for right now, Ronderslottet for Aker BP, which is a long-term project. It will kick off in 5 years or plus. And that's using other screen solutions, such as the hydraulic activated endurance hydraulic screens that Halliburton deliver, or with similar expandable screens from other vendors. The reason why this is preferable with bulk laterals is that you do it just like you do a line of deployment. You run them in, you activate them, you leave them, and you sting back to them afterwards without taking any additional time or adding additional time to your installation. An issue that's frequently coming up is how do you retain the production from your old main bore as you're drilling a lateral? That can be done by using the starburst system delivered from Weatherford, which is perforated whipstock that you just install in a main bore and packs it off temporarily. And then you're drilling and completing your lateral as you prefer. Afterwards, when you're going to open up the production against the main bore again, you just perforate through a whipstock, and you just reduce the pressure to get the well bore on production again. Another way you can do the same with the Halliburton system is more a flow full-blown MLT system, indicated on this picture, where you have access to the main bore afterwards. So if you can't get it kicked off, if it doesn't kick off by itself, you can actually go down and lift it. So both of those solutions are viable and are widely used, and it's possible to just it's available systems today. If you have a low permeability reservoir, a reservoir that doesn't really flow much, there are options of how you can do that with the other vendors' equipment as well. I mentioned fracking and stimulation, and they have their benefits, but you can also add things like fishbones MLT systems. This is just the same thing as I mentioned for the endurance hydraulic screens. You just add them to a line of deployment system and you tie back to them later, and you activate them before you pull your running string back out. I pointed at the wrong picture here, sorry. And then you tie back with the junction afterwards and seal it off, as I've shown on other pictures earlier today. So we are doing the first MLT with the fishbone system for Lundin later. I think it's about March we're going to get out onto that well. But that's on the main bore side. On the lateral side, it shouldn't be more complicated. It's just a slight modification to this tool, and you can do all of these operations on the spot. Some of the technologies I've talked about now is increasing the on a typical MLT, on a typical single well bore, you will be producing in between, if it's with standalone screens, you were just producing an area in between two seed formations, and that's what that's the gain you have from your lateral from the main board from your single well. If you add a lateral, of course, you double your you should be able to double your production, I should say, if it's a homogeneous reservoir. But if you are adding things like fishbone system, you also in or you are stimulating or fracking the well, you also increase you can increase your inflow area tremendously. And of course, you can do that on both sides of your reservoir. And these are the things that I think is essential with the MLT technology as such. I'll touch into what the MLT group is. When it comes to new technology and the applications of this, what I see that most of our engineering group or Halliburton's engineering group is spending time on today, on the MLT side, of course, it's various upgrades, or has been, I should rather say, it's various upgrades to the systems that we already have to optimize installations and to reduce downtimes. An example of that is a job that we're doing right, or a modification we're doing right now, and we're installing a deflector, which is a completion ripstock. Instead of just leaving it in hole and pulling out again, we're making it capable of the running tool capable of drifting the lateral at the same time. And if you don't manage to drift the lateral, you can pull the deflector on the same run. That will save operators that has a challenge with getting out with the screens later, something in between 5 to 10 days downtime when it's on the market. Another system that we're looking in, or we're working on, is an open hole level 5 MLT solution. That's a project that we have for Equinor these days. I can foresee that more coil tubing MLT solutions will come to the market. We are not currently working on it, but it's definitely something that we like to look further into. We have developed a 7 and 5/8 inch level 5 FlexRite system, and I foresee that that will be run probably within the first half year in 2021. A 7-inch system is being developed at the same time. I will presume that MLTs will be used for more water injectors in the future. Up till now, we only had it on one well on Fram, but that's been very successful according to what I hear from the Fram group. I'm not sure if MLTs is eminent for gas producers, because you normally just have a single well downhole and you just perforate it in a very short section and you produce. And they're normally producing really well. But if you have gas fields close by gas areas that sealed off with horizontal, for instance, it could be another alternative. Combined injectors and producers might be interesting, but I would say that not combined injectors and producers from the surface. It would more be that you produce from an area downhole and you inject in another area and then you produce from the main bore. The reason why I don't really like mixed injectors and producers is mainly because of the tube move and material selections. That makes it very challenging. Now we're coming into one of my babies and which is field development benefits. I have to do a few simplifications here. And first of all, that is that I have to expect that time and cost is the same. I'm getting that more or less confirmed from oil companies regularly, and it seems to be the fact even though after the modifications and effectiveness that's come with the downturns terms in the industry. Another thing I have is that all the laterals is of the same length, more or less, and typically they are, in average, it's a little bit longer laterals than main bores. So here again, I'm on the conservative side. Third one is that the percentages I'm using, they're taking from actual wells that we have been drilling, or we have been involved in, I would rather say, for operators in Norway. And not only us, two of these wells that you see in the graphs to the left here are actually drilled by one of our competitors as well. If you have a main bore drilled like I just indicated in PowerPoint here, that's defending the investment. That means that you could drill it and you could produce it and you would make money. You'd normally be happy with that. But think about it, if you add a lateral to this and you do that as an IOR project or just to deplete more of the reservoir at the same time, your cost or time cost, I should say, of drilling the lateral is a fourth of the main bore. So the required lateral contribution production-wise doesn't have to be more than 25% of what it was from the main bore. And of course, you can drill several laterals. In a different case where you have several smaller pockets of reservoir that you would, that doesn't necessarily stand by themselves. You can add laterals for about 20 to 25% of the time cost. And by drilling a quad like the one you see here, where we could actually four double your production area, it costs less than two single wells. And this is why I think MLT should have taken off much more than it has done in previous years. Another example is field development of a new four slot template. And if you have if you're adding three laterals, as I'm indicating on this slide, and I say that the lateral length is about the same as the main bore reservoir penetration, then you have added 75% of reservoir exposure. Since you have additional costs of facilities and pipelines and so forth that you have to pull into your equation, only 10 to 15% added production should justify this type of an investment. I know many good reservoir engineers that could gain more than that. I was asked to talk about risk considerations, and I would say that I had to pull some. I start that over. I pulled some risk considerations that we've been asked to talk about in some of our studies that we've done for various oil companies in on the Norwegian continent in Norway, and I just want to elaborate a little bit around them. The first one is, when you're doing a liner installation with the pre-milled window and you have to orient the window, how likely is that that's going to go good? I would say that if you don't have a specific reservoir challenge and you are able to reciprocate your string, you're able to turn the window as well. It's not the rotating we're going to do. It's orienting. So basically what we're doing is to put a torque into the string and we work it to get the window facing the way we want it to face. More challenging with that is things like our casing orienting tool, which is an electronic tool. And if that fails, you need to pull the string to surface and rerun the casing. Cementing, how sure are we that we're getting cementing of the pairing casing done well enough so we can use it as a barrier? That's more challenging because you can't rotate a string with a pre-milled window. But what you can do is you can either use foam cementing, or you can actually use these diverters that came just coming on the market right now. That's diverting the cement from above the string to below the string and ensures that you're getting a better bond and better cement job. For the sake of MLT window, we don't necessarily need it to be cemented all in place, but just to a certain degree fixed. But as a barrier, it's of course needs to have a good cement job. When it comes to MLT window milling, or I look at that more or less at side tracking, with the exception that you need to create a long window that you're going to have a repeated access to. So as long as you take your time and do time milling and don't try to do things as quickly as possible, it's normally really, it gives normally a good window for creating your MLT, later MLT operations, I should say. And that doesn't mean that you have that challenge in one of 10 wells. It's a seldom thing that happens, and then we just rework the window at a later stage. Whipstock retrievals can be challenging, but we always get the whipstock out of a hole if cleanliness is kept at a high level. We only left one whipstock in hole in Norway, and that was definitely in a very dirty well where it should not have been run in initially. Deflector installations can be challenging if you have debris in hole. It's a debris issue, and the same goes with the junction installation. What we have seen as a company is that these graphs, or these totems, or call them whatever you like, is indicating the how well things has gone over time. And they're split into areas of 5 years. And you can see in the early days, this is not only Norway, this is Halliburton as a whole. Unfortunately, I don't have this information for other suppliers as well. And you can see that the success rate was close to 90% in the early years, 95 to 99, and it's been climbing rapidly up to 100%. In a period 2015 to 2019, we didn't leave a single main bore or lateral uncompleted, but completed it as planned. And this is with more challenging wells coming on board as well. I borrowed this slide from Rystad, which used it on OG21 meeting forum a few years back. And I tried to indicate how we perceive risk compared to how we assess risk. And what they said is that if you look at the terrorist attack, for instance, we perceive it as a huge risk for ourselves. It could happen whenever, and it's not much of a chance that it really happens. What Rystad said is that applying new technology in oil and gas, it's perceived like a huge risk, and it is a risk, but it has an assessed risk, but it's lower than it's way lower than a perceived risk. For my own sake, I put MLT's technology in here, and it's definitely perceived as a bigger risk than other technologies in the oil industry. But actually, for my own sake again, I would say that the total picture, when you look at how often we lose a lateral or not, the picture of an MLT technology perceived risk compared to assessed risk is just about the same as for a terrorist attack or gun crime. So to make a quick conclusion before we take the break, I would say that multilateral drilling has a huge potential, and also for mature fields, and I would say on a mature continental shelf. You can use it on new field developments, but you can also use it for infill wells to increase your drainage area. I'll also say that MLT improves IOR significantly, and I really like the opportunity to talk about multilaterals as an IOR method. And it's a tremendous ongoing technology development going on right now, and it's definitely a lot of new tools and methods coming to the market shortly. So then we'll take a 10-minute break and we'll continue talking about, I'll show you a short video afterwards with Duva, and we can discuss how you can do an early evaluation on the field effectively. Thank you very much for the attention so far. I'm looking forward to continue the process afterwards.
Thank you, Tom, and we'll continue. You start the countdown, I see. So we'll start around 11 o'clock. Thanks.
Sure.